Put your hands together again for Nathan.
Put your hands together for Jesus. Come on. That was awesome, the worship this morning. Thank you so much, worship team. Thank you, Trevor, for taking us into that place, man. Isn't that amazing? I wanted to really just share a few insights and things that have really helped me over my life journey and working as a psychologist as well. It's really helped a lot of people. And just to get started, let's just pray. Lord, we just thank you so much for your presence in this place. We just thank you so much, Lord, for your presence in this place, Lord. What a privilege it is to be your child. What a privilege it is to be in your family, God. Just thank you, Lord, for your presence in this place. We worship you and we praise you, God. Amen. Lord, we, man, it was up to me. We just keep going, eh? Oh, good stuff. Honestly, I don't really know how to proceed. I've got a message, but I'm just being sincere. So. All right, good stuff. Good stuff. Thank you, Lord. Okay, I'm going to hold it. I don't normally do this. I'm sorry. I'm going to hold it together. Thank you for the water. All right, let's go. So, stop distracting me, guys. normally, I'm seriously not like that. It's like, this is so weird. That's fine. That's all right. Holy Spirit's going to make me look silly. That's good. That's good. It's seriously good because for a lot of years, like, so when I first got saved, man, like, it was amazing. God changed my life. I've gone through a lot of mental stuff, mental illness and stuff as a young'un, and I was in psych wards and medication, suicidal, the whole lot. Like, just there was a lot going on as a young guy, and just really disruptive family relationships. Didn't talk to my parents for a long time. Like as in like 10 years, and just it was like there's a lot of stuff that went on as a young man, and then I encountered the Lord, and it was actually a bit different. I came to the Lord through science. I was studying a Bachelor of Applied Science at university, and like all the lecturers are talking about like evolution, and they were talking about how God's, you know, in a sense God's like just a psychological construct that we've created as, in a sense, like a crutch kind of thing. They were like, no, we've moved, we've evolved beyond that. We don't no longer need that kind of religion, that kind of thing. But that actually sparked an interest for me to re-engage in a search, in a spiritual hunger developed in me. Because as a young person, like I went through all this stuff. I've gone through psychiatrists, I've gone through psychology, I've gone through all these things. And as I was studying psychology, I was trying to figure myself out, and it wasn't really working too well. And I had everything that the world said I should be happy with, and amazing. Like, we live in an amazing country, we live in an amazing place. Just the fact that we're here right now, what an amazing blessing and privilege it is. So I'm not complaining about any of that, but it was just something inside me was dead, and now I know what that was. But yeah, it actually sparked an interest. So I started researching, like, you know, if there is a God, if there is something out there, what is it? And I looked into different, you know, different things, like, you know, obviously philosophy. We had to do a course on that as well. And I hate philosophy, man. Like, it's all tautological. You just go around in circles and circles and ask questions about why is that? And then why do you ask the question in the first place? And, you know, why are you coming to that real, you know, it's just like, oh my goodness, isn't there like a truth, for goodness sake? And so that kind of process actually drove me into the gospel. And I started to, after looking at various other religions and various other things out there, like full-on weird stuff, you know, just I came back to a place. I'm just going to read the Bible. I'm going to crack open this book that I haven't looked at for a long time. And I started to just read it in my own personal time, my own quiet spaces. I just started researching, looking into it. And as I was reading the Bible, man, it was just like boom, boom, like it was hitting me in place. And this was over like a 3 to 6 month period. I can't really remember. I'm not too good on time. But as I was reading the word, it just started hitting me in place that it was just coming alive and something inside was being fed. And And during that time as well, I was looking into science and research on, you know, if there is a designer of this planet. And one of the lecturers at uni actually, there was a girl in the class that she asked a question about, I think it was intelligent design. She was like, and what do you think about intelligent design? And he just mocked her. He was just like, you know, you're an idiot kind of thing. But that, I was like, what's intelligent design? I started listening to that. And I was like, I wonder what that's all about. And the lecturer's attitude and his, like, approach to that kind of thing, I was like, man, how arrogant are you? Like, you're just going to shut someone down, a student that you're, like, 30, 40 years older, and you're going to shut her down like that. How rude. So that actually really sparked an interest in me to look into that stuff. So I saw that there is indeed a lot of design around us. There is an intelligent designer. And then I started looking into, well, who is this intelligent designer, if there is one? And so that's what led me back to the gospel, back to reading the Bible. And then I'm getting hit with the word of God, and it was just starting to transform me. So I could not do the stuff that I used to do freely, happily, used to carry on, do whatever I wanted to do. And now, like, it was like having a roadblock. So I used to enjoy doing this, so I'm just going to do it because I like it. And it was like something was starting to stop me, and my conscience started to come alive again. And so I couldn't speak the same way I used to speak. I couldn't look at the stuff. I couldn't do certain things that I used to do. And the Holy Spirit was arresting me by transforming my mind without me even realizing it was happening. It was awesome. So, and there's a process, there's a journey as we enter into a relationship with Jesus. It's not just a one-time, bang, you're done, that's it, you're fixed forever. There's a journey in that process. And I wanted to kind of just touch on that today. I'm conscious of time, and I can talk about this stuff for, like, you know, years, man. Like, this is seriously a great passion of mine. So I'm just going to sort of touch on a few things. God radically transformed my life at that point. And then I got involved in ministry, in different things, working full-time as well, went on mission trips. Man, like, the Philippines is awesome place. When I went to the Philippines, I saw people worshiping, kind of like that, what happened here today. But it was like these people, man, like these little kids would come up on the street, and we were just doing like street ministry and stuff. And these little kids would come up like wearing hardly anything, just full on dirty, like just they've never showered or something. Like, it was just really sad to see. And they go back to their houses, which was not a house, man. Like, it was like shanty towns made of, like, you know, just literally tin. It was made out of tin. Like, it's just like crazy, man. Like, these people live there. And they'd have, like, you know, 10 kids in this one little thing. And so seeing that, and then watching them worship, like, they were just jumping around, they were just having fun, they were just loving it. They'd take their sandals off and smack them together and just, like, you know, just jump up and down. They're so free. And there I am, I'm like a Westerner, you know, like just playing my guitar and singing, like, hallelujah, like, you know. And I love today what was happening. That is, man, I believe that freedom is just going to increase and continue. And it was just amazing today. I love it. And that's kind of reminds me of that mission trip and what God is doing all around the world. Like, you know, he's just, man, he's setting people on fire for him. So, amen. So I wanted to just share one of the things that really, really changed my life. So I went through kind of ministry and working and all that kind of stuff. And then I was really seeking God. I was like, what do you want me to do now? And he just said, read my word, eat it, consume it. It was really big on just read the Bible, read the Bible, read the Bible. And so I'm like, okay, what else do you want me to do? He's like, no, just read my word, eat it, consume it. And then it was like, I started doing that more and more and more. 6 months later, it's like, what do you want me to do now? It's like, read my word, eat it, consume it. So I just keep going, keep eating it. And there was an opportunity that came up to go to the States and study at a Bible college there whilst interning at a drug and alcohol rehab. And living on site at the rehab, and it also was a homeless shelter. So I'm like, yeah, let's do that, you know. A young, you know, in my early or mid-20s, I'm like, all right, let's go for it, let's do it. And now in hindsight, man, like, you know, doing that now, I'm like, well, that was a bit of a risk, but just went for it. And praise God, because it was amazing. And at this particular Bible college, it really helped me, because all they read is the Bible. You'd think at a Bible college, at a seminary, they would study the Bible. But very often, unfortunately, in seminaries and Bible colleges, they study all these other books about the Bible, but they miss out on reading the Word, man. So this particular college really blessed me, because I just spent so much time in the Word, day in, day out. Single man, no kids, no other responsibilities. I was just like in the Word. And that's something that I've had to really cultivate and facilitate now as a father of two, as a husband, working full time. You guys know it, you know, and of course the mothers know it as well. It's hard, man. Like, it's hard to find that time again and to really spend time. But you will make time for what you value. And, you know, you'll make time for... And when what I find as well is when I try to make it happen, I try to value God, what happens is I try to do it in my own strength and I lose the joy and I lose the kind of the wells of salvation come through that joy that we carry. And so it's actually, I just ask God, man, God, help me please have a passion for you. Help me to value you the way that, you know, you deserve it. And it starts to come back, that passion. And one of my personal things is like music and worshiping through music. Just the passion comes back, the value, man, like just shifts my perspective and it really helps me to stay fresh. So 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, if you want to pull up that scripture. And so as I was saying, like going through all of that, and one of the things that really helped me through that time was just reading the Word. It just started to cleanse my soul. It started to cleanse my heart, my mind from all that stupid stuff that I went through as a kid, all that stuff that I was subjected to, all the lies and deception and things that were just, without me even realizing, they were just simmering away at the bottom. And that just started to really cleanse me. Just like if you get a cup of water and it's full of impurities, you start, the best way to do that is just put fresh water in that thing and it just starts to cleanse it. The impurities get overflowed and just gets taken out. And one of the key principles that has blessed me through that time that God taught me was in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. And it says, Paul saying, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, as in W-H-O-L-L-Y. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, folks, we are made of three-part beings. We are a spirit, a soul, and a body. And when we receive Jesus Christ, we start to come alive. Our spirit comes alive. And what I learned was I need to have a balance in my spirit, my soul, and my body. It's no good just getting like all this, counseling and psychology and getting your soul like some amazing superpower soul or whatever, you know, and getting all these motivational talks in you and getting all this, soul work done, which is really, really beneficial. I'm not against it, but I'm telling you, going through it and being a practitioner of psychology, it will not transform your heart. Only Jesus can do that. And I'm telling you guys, like, this is an amazing truth, because if you look at this, you see spirit, soul, and body. It's talking about balance to your life. So if you're just all spirit, 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 which again, I'm fully for, like, it's amazing. But I've seen so many Christians, ministers that have come for counseling, good men of God, that are just out of balance, and they come and they're like, man, I'm struggling. I don't know what's going on. And it's just about realigning their soul and their body into health. And often they'll condemn themselves because they're like, I'm a minister, or even us as, you know, just wherever you're at, I shouldn't think this way, or I shouldn't feel this, or I shouldn't dot, dot, dot. You add in the blanks. But what I'm trying to say is that there is a process to that, to finding balance back into your life. And God is all for it. He's not against it. He's all for your soul to be healthy and whole. He's all for your body to be well as well. One of the key things I do with anyone that comes to see me is we look at the body, all right? We look at diet, sleep, and exercise. Don't talk to me about your thoughts if you're not sleeping well. You need to get some good sleep, and then we'll talk about your thought process. Don't talk to me about, I want to fix this relationship and blah, 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 but you're eating like junk food every day. You're eating Maccas every day. Come on, like, let's get healthy. And that's what I'm trying to say is like diet, sleep, exercise. If you're not exercising, you're not taking care of yourself, there's a process, there's a place for that in the body. And, you know, obviously in our own personal journey, but also in the body of Christ. You know, I'm all for 100%, man, like get into it, get in the worship, get in the Word of God. Like I was saying, that's what transformed my heart. But we need to take care of our bodies as well and our soul. And so I want to sort of just bring that as the foundation of this message. And the other thing I want to really, really talk about is perspective. So if you want to just pull up the first picture there, if you please. Spirit, soul, body one first. Because I want to just look at, there it is, sorry. So you can see over here that this is I didn't create this diagram, but I refer to it a lot. But in your center, in the core of your being, in your identity, who you really are is found in your spirit as a born-again Christian. Your spirit is where you find meaning, purpose, where you find love, where you experience the fruits of the gospel. You begin to experience love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. That's all resident in your spirit. That's what Christ has done inside of you. It's resident in your spirit. The journey of the Christian life, however, is to take what's in your spirit by faith and start to release it into your soul. That's where it talks in Romans 12 verse 2 is that don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. What's that talking about? Man, don't just think or function like the rest of the world. Let's actually take what's inside of you, what Christ has deposited, what he paid the price on the cross to give you, and you begin to access that in your soul realm through your, you know, through renewing your mind, through the word. You start to release those truths, you replace the lies and the deception that's held you captive. And then that starts to impact on the way that you relate to other people as well. It starts to impact on your physical health as well. You know, begin to release. So, for example, healing. So before I was like, you know, knew all this stuff about healing and all that kind of thing. My mum, when I was living at home, my mum was unwell and she had a terrible migraine. She would get these migraines all the time. And as I'm spending time reading the word, I read this scripture. It says, the kingdom of God's not a matter of talk, but of power. I'm like, all right, God, prove it then. Come on. You know, I was arrogant and you know, I was like trying to, I was on this journey seeking God, seeking what is the truth. And I went downstairs, saw my mum, and that scripture straight away came back to my mind when I saw my mum. And I was like, mum, what's wrong? And she's like, oh, I've just got a terrible migraine. And she used to get this all the time. But this time I'm like, no, okay, let me pray for you. And she almost fell off the chair, man. Because remember, like we've got a great relationship now. But prior to all this transformation, it wasn't very good. So she was like, okay, you know, it's a bit weird. And then I just laid my hand on her head or whatever. I can't really remember what I did. And I said, kingdom of God, it's not a matter of words, but of power, be healed. Something like that. Just, I don't even really know what I was doing or saying. I said, do not take medication. Don't do anything different. Let's just wait and see if this works. And she's like, okay. So I was around. I watched her. I was looking. Yeah, is she taking anything? No, no. You know, I was very skeptical. I thought this is all a bunch of, you know, it's all a hoax. It's all a mind trick. But I was watching her and nothing changed. Like, you know, she didn't do anything. She didn't do anything different. And within 5 minutes, she's like, oh, I'm feeling a lot better. I'm like, just wait, let's see, we'll come back, you know, kind of thing. I didn't say that, but I was thinking it. And then like about an hour later, I'm like, how are you going? And I could see like she was doing what she was cooking, she was doing all this stuff. You know, I come from a Wog family, she cooks a lot of food. You know, she's amazing. That's, Wog means Western Oriental Gentleman, thank you very much. And she was doing an amazing thing and it was like, wow, okay, this is real. And that started to spark this interest in me. And then, oh man, I've got to tell you this one as well. I mean, I was healed personally from a lot of things in my journey as well, physically, emotionally, like mental stuff. But I was in the Philippines, like I was saying earlier, and there was this little girl that came up to us for prayer. And one of her legs was literally like so much shorter than the other one. It was a significant amount shorter. And my friend was you know, okay, can we pray for you? Because her mum brought her up to us. And she didn't speak English or anything like that. So she didn't know what we were going to do or anything. And so my friend prayed for her and just said, you know, leg, grow out. It's not really your typical prayer, I suppose. He just commanded the leg to come out. It's like, leg, come out. And literally in front of my eyes, I just saw her leg just go whoosh, like that out. And I was like, that is amazing. That's so cool. You know, and I was like, man, if that's possible, why aren't we doing this more? You know, and like, and so that's, again, like that, it just started going for it more and more. And I've seen like lots of stuff. Praise God. Like you won't see stuff if you don't do stuff, you know? So a lot of the time I was always complaining, oh, you know, this isn't real. God doesn't heal. But I never prayed for anyone. I never stepped out and you know, just jumped into it. And no wonder I didn't see anything because I wasn't ever pursuing it. You know, the more you pursue it, the more you begin to see. When our son was unwell, when he was first born, he had a lot of health issues and we were in the hospital and we saw so many people get touched and get healed in the hospital while our son was unwell. And it was just an amazing time that, you know, our perspective and our identity wasn't in our circumstance or in the situation. And we had the opportunity to pray for so many people. And it was an incredible, incredible time, incredibly difficult as well. Don't get me wrong. man, we were battling stuff. We were like trying to stay, you know, stay focused, stay. But I'm telling you, like, it's amazing when you do this journey with God. You will have troubles, but it's a lot better going through it with Him. Oh, my goodness. So 1 Thessalonians, we read that. If you want to just put up the first picture there, I want to talk about perspective and how that impacts on your heart. So we've got a picture here. It's a visual illusion. You've probably seen this before. Who can see a vase? Yeah, you can see a vase. Who can see two faces? Yeah. Who can see both? You've probably seen it many times. Next picture. Now, how many legs does this elephant have? What do you guys think? Yell it out, yell it out. 4, 6, 8. It's a bit trippy, isn't it? How many legs does the elephant have? I'm going to leave that. I'm not going to answer it. I don't know either. Honestly, that's the trick. It's so trippy. I've done this in psychiatric hospitals. Probably not the best idea. and that's a psychologist joke, but sorry. But no, it's good fun. Next slide, please. What do you see here? What animal do you see? A rabbit? A duck? You see the duck? You see the rabbit? Everyone's like, Good stuff. And I would put it forward that if you've had more access to rabbits, if you've had a pet as a rabbit, you're most likely to see a rabbit because that's what your brain's, wired to observe those features. If you know ducks more, if you walk around a lake more often and you see ducks more often, you're more likely to see a duck. So what you're wired towards, what you're focused on, what you've experienced, all these things influence your perspective, your perception of things. So some people will say, nah, man, that's a duck. And again, I've done this in hospitals, I've done this in different places, and people will like swear by it. Like, no, it's not a duck. You know, they get really upset. It's like, just take a breath. Can you see this? Can you see the outline? Oh, sorry, I apologize. Yes, I can see it now. So next slide, please. So here, we won't do this one. Next one, please. That one will just trip us out too much. Who's holding who? Who's holding you in this one? Yeah, you're right. Who said that? You're too clever. So the guy is holding the girl, but it's a bit of a like, oh, is that really? Oh, I'm not sure. So it's a bit of a trick there. But perspective, as it says, perspective makes all the difference. How you see things will affect how you see things, and it's going to affect your heart. And it starts to influence how you act, how you think, how you feel. So take like today's worship session. You know, if you came in and you're not used to that kind of thing, you're more reserved and you're like, you know, no, I'm not doing that, then you're not going to experience the fullness of that whole amazing, beautiful experience. But if you're willing and open to being like, you know what, I'm just going to jump in, just give it a crack, just have some fun, just like we do at the football or up here we at the rugby, just go for it. You begin to experience the fullness, the breadth of that experience in your spirit, in your soul, and in your body. You know, that's why worship, this is not my message, but you see Moses when he was fighting that battle, and Hur, H-U-R, and Aaron held his arms up. That's why we lift our arms. It's a representation that over the battle, I am going to lift my arms and worship and praise God. Now, there's all this symbology that we use, these metaphors we use in worship. Dancing, you know, it's freedom. There's so much around that. God dances over you with joy. He rejoices over you with dancing. So all these things that we do in worship is a representation of scripture, of biblical principles and tools that God's given us to activate what's in our spirit and release that into our soul and our body. And physical movement is just as valid a form of worship as singing and playing an instrument. Something my wife has been teaching me. She's an amazing dancer. She's incredible. And she'll do all these twirls and all this stuff. And honestly, as you know, this is my own confession, I was a bit like, oh, that's not really worship, you know. But it's just as valid. It's even more powerful a form of worship at times than singing even. You know, it's all good. It's all, we need to all activate this. And I really see this church as a dancing church, as a place of movement, as a place of just going for it. So come on. Next scripture is So perspective makes all the difference, doesn't it? So Proverbs 4:24, and here we have a scripture about our heart and how to guard and protect our heart, how to keep it cleansed and pure. If I can open it up. I love old schoolness. I love going into the Word, the actual Bible. I'm not against technology at all, but just for me, it just feels right. Proverbs 4:24. Start from 23. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Put away from you a froward mouth and perverse lips put far from you. Let your eyes look right on and let your eyelids look straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be established. Turn not to the right hand nor to the left. Remove your foot from evil. And remember how I was saying, I'm going quickly here because I'm conscious of time. But remember how I was saying that when I started reading the Word, it started to stop me and put barriers when I used to be able to do this and find pleasure in it and whatever. I was no longer able to do that. And it was like, God, what are you doing? Like, you know, just what's going on? And what was happening was God was helping to heal me and stop me from certain behaviors that were unhealthy and toxic and causing my mind and my soul to be poisoned by this stupid stuff that goes on in the world. And he was trying to teach me to actually stay pure and do this scripture that you actually, and that helped my mental health more than anything, man. Like that was an incredible blessing that time that God was teaching me, the Holy Spirit was teaching me to not engage in certain things. And so there's a four-step process. What we speak or listen to, we can see in verse 25 there. Oh, sorry, 24. Put away from your froward mouth. So what you speak is really, really important. And you're the one listening and hearing that. I've counseled a lot of guys that come to me and they're the whole life, man, they've just been knocked down. I remember a mum brought her 12-year-old, and this is in another place, different location. You won't be able to identify them, and maybe I'm not even telling you the truth. So confidentiality is so important. But this mum brought her son, and he was like, you know, this, and in front of the son, she's saying, this, you know, this kid, his name, let's just say, was John. John's he's an idiot. He's, look at him, he's like so rude, so obnoxious to me. I'm just sick of him. He's just rubbish, you know, he's just blah, 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 doesn't want to go to school. And I was like, are you serious? Mum, like talking like that in front of your son, not let alone like, you know, just in front of him talking like that, even just about him like that. No wonder there's a reaction, a response, you know, from him in this manner. And it turns out there was a lot else going on. And so, you know, if you start, and now imagine that son hears that all day in, day out, I'm this, I'm that, I'm negative. What does the son start to do? He starts to speak that out. He starts to hear it, starts to listen to it. And I'll get into another scripture later, but it's not the external stuff that defiles us. It's the internal stuff that we believe that affects our heart. That's the stuff that really starts to impact and influence us. And then so what we speak, what we listen to, what we see, you know, I'm not going to get into too much details around that, but what you're looking at, what you're focused on, what your perspective, what your your vision, you know, where is that? Like not just in terms of visually, but also mentally, what your vision is, what you're looking, what you're seeing. You know, I'll look at a situation and I'll be like, man, this is mad. Like, this is awesome. This is fantastic. This is an opportunity. Look at this. This is great. Whereas someone else, you know, maybe a client or someone else that's looking at the same situation is like, this is horrible. This is terrible. This is, oh my goodness. You know, I'm sure we've all had those experiences. And as a counselor, as a friend, as a, you know, whatever you are as well, like your opportunity is to help and lead that person in compassion, in love toward a truthful avenue. And in today's society, I'm not going to get too political, but there's a lot of apps. Oh man, I'll refrain. But there's so much going on in today's society that I'm just like, are you serious? Like, oh my goodness, this is absolute ridiculous. And then they'll use psychology, they'll throw in some technical medical terms and they'll say blah, blah, blah. And they'll act as if it's scientifically proven and dot, dot, dot. I'm like, and then you actually look, I actually like to look at the research. I look at the studies, look at the statistical quotes and, quotients and everything. You look at the data, you do a data analysis on the sample sizes. And you're like, you only analyzed like 200 people and Australia's, you know, 25 million. And I'm like, that's how I think. And I'm like, break down the research. And you're like, this is absolute nonsense. And now you're trying to change culture based on a handful of, you know, unfortunate experiences and unfortunate propositions. And what I'm trying to say is that God is good. Think and dwell on. That's number three. Think and dwell on what you think and you dwell on. Often, I'm a very introverted person. I'll very often dwell on things. I'll sit there and I'll stew on it. A conversation, a handshake, and blah, blah, blah. Not so much anymore because I usually get slapped by my child and then he'll like wake me up and snap me out of it. But, very often I'll find I need to be conscious and aware of what I'm dwelling on, what I'm stewing on is really important. And so that's another key that God's trying to show us through this scripture, what you're focused and what you're dwelling on. I won't jump there right now, but there's a scripture in the New Testament. It talks about think on these things, dwell on these things, whatever is good, whatever is pure, whatever is on it. And it goes through a list of things that enables us to see, I can actually refocus my attention on these things. And then the final part there is what you do is really important. So it says there, ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be established. Turn not to the right hand nor to the left. Remove your foot. So you've got to actually sometimes remove yourself from that temptation. Remove yourself from that negative influence, that negative relationship. And I counsel a lot of Christians that think that they need to. Loving means that I need to stay in this toxic environment. No. A lot of Christians don't have a healthy boundary setting ability, or they haven't learned that I can actually assert myself and say that behavior is not okay. So they go, and unfortunately, I won't get too much into that, but there's so much that goes on in our family lives, in our relationships that no one else knows, no one else sees it. And that's not okay, man. Like, your relationship with God starts in your own personal room. It starts in your quiet place. And then it translates to your relationship with your most significant other. So if you're married, that would be your spouse. And then it's with your children. And it's not okay to just like be all like, you know, on Sunday and stuff. And then you give your missus misery. And then you do all this other stuff. Man, like there's so much freedom in just letting your personal quiet time with God come out toward your family and your relationship with other people as well. And so, you know, what you do in the secret place is so important. But the importance of your heart, in Romans 10 verse 12, it says that with the heart man believes unto righteousness. So if we just quickly have a look there. So all these things that we just said, what you speak, see, think and do, influence the condition of your heart. And in Romans 10, 12, we see that the heart, your heart is such a significant thing, man. It's like it's the part of you that receives salvation. It's the part of you that starts to be transformed. That's the part of you that God really wants. You know, we all say like, you know, I don't want, you know, you're this or you're that. I want your heart and then I'll have everything else. And that's what God's looking for. He's not interested in all these other things. He is, but as long as your heart is right. And so that's the thing that must come first. And it says, therefore, with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So when we do that prayer, perhaps even after the service today, we'll do a prayer and we'll say, Lord, you know, I receive you in my heart. When we say that, it's not the prayer itself that is going to transform you magically like a spell or something. It's actually the heart that you might have, hopefully, when you're praying that prayer, that releases the confession that my heart is making a decision to go after Jesus. And then when you leave here, that continues. It continues to develop that, continue to grow. And the same thing, you see, man, I'm just getting too excited. In Galatians chapter 4, let's just go there. Just get into it. It's awesome. Galatians chapter 4. Where am I? Are you guys okay? Is it all right? I know I'm going quickly. Where am I? Galatians 4 verse 4 to 7. So just talking about Jesus here, when the fullness of time in verse 4, when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, Galatians 4 verse 4 to 7, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Amen. Wherefore you are no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. When that truth, that revelation of that truth starts to impact on your identity, you begin to receive that in your heart, that becomes your belief system. Everything else like starts to be influenced by that, the way you think about, you know, your past. So I mean, like with me in my past, I'm like, I'm going to use that for God's glory. I'm going to be able to share and, you know, go into the field that I was dominated by. I'm actually now going to go into that and be a voice of reason, be someone that God's called me to do. And, you know, same with you guys. Like, I'm sure wherever you're at, whatever you're doing right now, there's a place that God's placed you there for a reason, for a purpose. And often we're looking out there. I remember being at Bible college, and of course at Bible college you're seeking God, hopefully, you know, and you're wanting to know what's the path to go forward. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And God kept saying, you know, I want you to become before you do. And that was amazing. And we're all still becoming. We're all still growing. And none of us are perfect, but He's developing character. He's developing your identity, grounded and founded in Him. And so anyway, but you can actually do the stuff, but not have that grounding and identity in Him, that foundation in Him. And the stuff won't satisfy you. I've been in ministry. I've done all that stuff. And man, I was just as miserable at times and as I am now in the secular workforce. Ministry will not satisfy. You know, being on this stage, it means nothing if you don't have a relationship with Him. You know, all this stuff is just false, like if it's not coming from the right heart motive in Him. And so just to encourage you guys, like, just keep loving Jesus, man. Like, He will lead you, guide you. He'll place you where you need to be, all that kind of stuff. You know, let yourself be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. It might be a phone call you need to make. It might be something that's, you know, so. And then in Mark chapter 7, I touched on this briefly just a bit earlier. Something that really blessed me is the revelation that what's in my spirit is sealed. It can't be touched. In Ephesians, it goes into more detail around that. But often, you know, we hear all this stuff like, you know, I need to get born again. I need to be born again. I sinned, so I need to go and get born again. No. What's in your spirit is sealed, and it's sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. It can't be touched. It can't be tampered with. It can't be changed. What's in your spirit is done. It's a done deal. It's been sealed, and you've got to receive that revelation, because otherwise, when you are struggling, when something happens, and there's an external influence, you start to think that there's, you know, you're not changed. You're the same person. What's wrong with me? But that's your soul. That's the part of your mind that's being transformed, your emotions and all of that kind of thing. Often I'll counsel someone. They'll be like, I'm struggling with anxiety. I'm struggling so much with anxiety. I'm like, okay, that's okay. That's an emotion. What's going on underneath the emotion? What's driving that? And it's a thought process. It's a belief. It's something that's resident in their heart that's driving that emotional response to the situation. And so it's not about condemning yourself for having an emotion. Emotion's good. And often I'm working a lot now with veterans, and often they'll have PTSD and that kind of thing. I would have it too if I was in that situation. So it's about normalizing the experience, and that emotional reaction that's okay. It's about what's driving it and what's causing it to become a dysfunctional thing. And so you actually look a bit deeper. What's the thought process? What's the belief? What's that that's driving it? And then you begin to change that. But focusing on the emotion, I shouldn't feel anxious. I shouldn't feel this way. I shouldn't feel that. You're just going to get more anxious. It's like, don't think about a pink elephant. What are you going to think about? A pink elephant, for goodness sake. You know, it's so typical. Don't think about an ice cream. You begin to taste the ice cream, for goodness sake, just thinking about it. You know, so it's like the more you try to stop feeling something, the more you're going to experience it and feel it. So it's actually one of the, just this is a tip, one of the things I do a lot with anxiety clients is look at just distraction things that we can do to just distract ourselves in the moment. So attending to the five senses around us. So looking around you. So let's say that you're at the shopping center, social phobias and things like that. You're at the shopping center. You're starting to feel your heart palpitations. You're starting to feel the thoughts are hitting you. What am I doing? You start to sweat like I am now. You know, all those sorts of things start to occur. And then you think, oh, I'm getting anxious. I shouldn't feel anxious. Oh my goodness, I can't do this. And then you leave and you don't overcome that fear. One of the things, and this is a journey, it's not like, don't go and try this if you have been struggling. I'm not, you know, telling you just do this and you're going to be fixed. Not at all. You know, this is a journey, it's a process, there's a lot that goes into it. But one of the things that can be useful is looking around you, just attending to the environment, not focusing on the body and the experiences you're having, and starting to notice the sounds around you. You know, if we stopped right now, starting to notice your breathing, your breath, you know, starting to notice these things around you and just, you know, just noticing things around you. Like it's just a simple technique, something that's really helped a lot of people in the moment of feeling anxiety, attending to their body and their soul and starting to just, you know, tap into that. That's okay. That's normal. Now, I'm not into mindfulness as such as maybe the world would present it, like meditation and all that kind of stuff. But I am into being mindful, in the mindful of the gospel, mindful of, I believe that in the, well, I'm not just saying that, but in the Bible, it talks about meditating on the word. And God is actually the founder of that. And anything that works, that I've found personally, anything that works in psychology, anything that works in these allied health fields is really founded in, and based in scriptural examples. You know, they're scriptural principles that function so well, and the world's taken them and said, oh, we'll slap this label onto it, and this is what it is. You know, it's DBT, it's ACT, it's CBT, it's all these other acronyms. If you've been in counseling, you know what I'm talking about. But really what works and what's really powerful is that they're all founded and grounded in biblical principles. And when we do it in compassion as love, in compassion and in love, and speak the truth in love, it can really set people free and really help them. And then finally, I just wanted to turn to Romans chapter 12, verse 2, which I have touched on. And then after that, I'll go to Psalm 119, verse 9. But in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may know what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And so again, it's that idea around, letting your soul be renewed through the word of God. And I'll prove it. In Psalm 119, it takes time. It takes a lot of time. Don't think that you just go to see a psychologist and you're going to be fixed in one session. It takes time. Like, it takes time to heal relationships. If you've been abusive towards your partner, it takes time to restore trust. You know, so often I'll see a guy will come and say, oh, my wife needs to, dot, 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 and she just needs to this. She needs. It's like, man, look how you're talking about. You're just being an idiot. Like, stop being like that toward her, and she maybe won't act like that, you know? And there's, and she needs help as well. She needs support, of course. But how you're treating her is actually having the effect that you're complaining about. So Psalm 119, verse 9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? How do I cleanse my way? How do I change? How do I transform my heart? By taking heed thereto according to your word. And then in verse 11, your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. You know, so we hide God's word in our heart. We let God's word transform us and cleanse us. Just like that cup of water starts to take out the impurities and start to cleanse us and transform our hearts. And that starts in the secret place. The final scripture, and I'll just give me one more or so minutes. Very quickly, I just wanted to touch on, we got Caleb and Joshua, and we've got the 10 spies, so they're going out into this land. And they're commissioned. This is in Numbers chapter 13 and chapter 14, if you want to look at it later. I won't turn to it now, but we got these spies, and God told, in Numbers chapter 13, verse 1, God tells Moses to do this. So this is coming from God's mouth, like he's telling these guys to go for it. I want you to go into this land, spy out the land, look at it. You know, basically, I want you to go and see where your new home is. You know, this is going to be your new address. And so Moses goes and tells Joshua and these guys to go for it, and they elect certain people, and it goes through every single person's name. And they're all leaders in their tribes. These are men like CEOs. These are executives. These are like the managers. These are the people that, these are accomplished people. It's not just choosing like a 15-year-old or something. Nothing wrong being 15. But you know what I mean. So he's going for these people that have experience and that kind of thing. And these guys go and they look at the land. And they see that it's fruitful. They bring back these grapes. They bring back this stuff that it's amazing. It's incredible. And they're like, wow, this is amazing. And then they come back and they give the report to Moses and the rest of Israel, the rest of the tribe. And these 10 guys, they're like, yeah, it's amazing. It's great. The grapes are massive. This is awesome. Such a beautiful land. But there's these guys, the giants, the Anak people, the giants, it's good, but no, we can't do this. You know, their perspective, they're focused on the giant, they're focused on not on God's promises. They're focused on all the stuff. And the same thing that I find with perspective, with the pictures, we're focused on a certain way of looking at something, and that's stopping us from really receiving what's already resident in our spirit. It's stopping us, perhaps, and I'm not condemning anyone, it might be stopping you from receiving a deeper level of healing. It might be stopping you from experiencing greater level of joy and freedom in your relationship. I mean, I'm married and I know it's not easy. You know, it's a tough road sometimes. You know, like even recently we had an argument and I'm like, man, I've got to preach on Sunday. I can't focus now. For goodness sake, And I'm trying to fix my notes up and I'm trying to like focus. And I'm like, I've got to go spend time with God, And God's just like, go and fix it. I was like, no, I'm going to go pray. I'm going to, you know, so I'm like, I drive off and I'm, you know, I'm just going to go get my sermon ready and I've got to preach and blah, blah, blah. And God's like, no, no, just go fix the relationship. Just go have a chat. Go say sorry. You know, just sort it out. And it's okay. You know, just, and praise God. Like I just did it, you know, it took me a while. But, you know, so it's, I'm just being honest. Like, you know, it's not easy. And I'm not saying anyone's perfect. But these principles, these ways of functioning, you access what's resident in your spirit. Now, I can't do that in my flesh, man. Like, I can't do that in the soul. My body doesn't want to do it. But in my spirit, that's what, you know, Holy Spirit tapping away. It's coming alive. It's like, no, no, come on. There's a better way to do this. And it's like, oh, now my sermon makes sense. You know, now it's like everything else starts to be cleansed and clarified and so much easier. So there's those guys. They're like, ah, there's giants in the land. We're like little grasshoppers to them. We can't do this, blah, blah, blah. And then you've got Joshua and Caleb, and they're like, nah, this is awesome. Let's go right now and overcome them. They're just like, don't even worry about the planning. Let's just do it now. Let's go for it. And I believe that's really God's heart. He's just like, come on, let's go. Let's do it. Let's go. Let's go. But we wait so long, you know, so often we look at things around us that are like, no, I can't do it because of this reason. Can't do it because of that. Can't do this. Can't do that. Now, I'm going to put the precursor that God told them very clearly to do this. Their leadership, Moses, had ordained them to do this. And now they're going into it and they're doing it and they're like, no, we can't do it. So what I'm saying is that if God's told you, if leadership and people around you that you trust are all for it and they've commissioned and ordained you to do it, and then you're still like, no, 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 I can't for whatever reason, I'm encouraging you to take that step. Allow yourself to go into that place with Him, with the Lord, focus on His promise and just see what happens, man. Just go for it. It's amazing. So Joshua and Caleb are like, no, we can do this. We can overcome it. They're not looking at the giant. They're looking at the promise. And in a sense, and then actually not in a sense, in Numbers chapter 14, verse 24, it says that Caleb was able to do that because he had a spirit, a different spirit than all the other guys. He had a spirit, a mindset, a perspective in chapter 14, verse 24, that was focused on the promise, that was focused on God. But my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit in him and has followed me fully. You see, Caleb's spirit, his focus was on God and on His promise. And so our spirit, remember that diagram I showed you before, spirit, soul, body. Our spirit, what is it? In Galatians 4, what did we have before? It says that our spirit, we've received the Holy Spirit of promise. We've received the Spirit of God, the Spirit of His Son, Jesus. And Jesus' spirit, the Holy Spirit is resident inside each and every one of you if you're born again. The Holy Spirit is inside you. And I get really excited about it because that is like, when you access that, when you realize that truth, suddenly, you know, we're looking at buying a house and getting stressed about that and going into this and that. This has been like a 2-3 year journey for us. And, you know, it's like you get stressed. It's like, well, no, no, the Holy Spirit's resident inside of me. Why am I stressing out about it? There's a timing, there's a season, and God's leading and guiding us without us even realizing it. And I'm sure for you as well, my son, my daughter is going through this, is going through that. You've got the Holy Spirit of promise inside of you. You've actually got the Spirit of God alive and working well in you, and you can access that. You can actually start to release that by faith, by what you speak, what you see, what you think, and dwell on what you do. I mean, I'm so excited about this. This is something that I've seen. I was doing this in psychiatric hospitals, like with non-Christians. You know, I was still talking about the spirit, talking about the soul, talking about the body. And they're just like, yeah, that makes so much sense. It's a biblical principle. You know, and I didn't quote 1 Thessalonians, but I'm like just leading them down this journey of realizing that, yeah, man, I've got a spirit that needs to come alive. How do you do that? Through Jesus. You know, so there's a place to, you know, anyway, I'm just getting ahead of myself there. But I wanted to just say, if you're not born again, if you don't know Jesus in this place, this is a great opportunity to make that decision to follow Him. As we read before in Romans 10 verse 12, that if you believe in your heart Jesus was born again, that he died and was raised again for your sins, for the remission of your sins, to take away your wrongdoing, you can actually begin to receive His life and be born again. And that gives you a new identity. It makes your spirit come alive. And you begin to, you know, journey and renew your mind to that truth and that reality. And I'm just going to hand it over to my friend Kent, and he's going to lead us in that. But thank you so much, guys. Bless you.